Hello everyone, welcome to the stream. It's Friday and it's time for a good AmigaOS stream. Welcome, I'm George. You can find me as Volquero on various Amiga forums. Today we are going to see, we are going to continue with AmigaOS 4.1 streaming, and we are going to talk about the my system and some interesting stuff that I would like to show you. And let's start. As you can see, the music that we listen to right now is, I'm using GIMP 3, the latest version, and it's working just fine on the AmigaOS 4. But let me stop it right now and start talking about the AmigaOS 4.1. How are you doing, everyone? Are you holding well? Ready for the weekend? I hope so. The last streams we talked about some of the main folders that come with the AmigaOS 4.1 and applications. We saw about the prefs folder, the emulation folder. We talked about the utilities, the various utilities that come with AmigaOS 4.1 and for the system. The rest of the folders that you can find after your installation is pretty much the same like the AmigaOS 3. And we can talk today about devs and storage, and we can see the similarities with AmigaOS 3. Welcome, Livelord. Welcome to the stream. How are you doing? Is the sound well? Can you hear me well? So we are going to see today the devs and storage and some of the hidden folders that exist to every AmigaOS installation. So we don't have too much to say actually, because devs and storage are both pretty similar folders. In devs we have the data types, DOS drivers, key maps, monitors, whatever we need for this AmigaOS to work fine. Let's see each and every one of them. Data types is the folder where we hold all the data types that we want to be executed and started whenever we boot our system. Those data types, if you are not familiar, the AmigaOS has a unique way to use different types of files. We use data types which are describing a type of file, and with data types help, applications can gain access to these files. For example, MultiView is an application that uses data types, and based on the data types that you have, it can support the different types of music or music files or images. So even that this application was developed without supporting any type of file, using the data types we can extend its support, and we can make it work as we want and support different types of files that might never existed when MultiView was created. And right now we have here all these data types. And the difference between devs and storage folder, because in storage folder we might also have data types, is that the ones that are inside the devs, they are always executed whenever your system is booting. If you want something to be disabled for the next boot, you can move it to the storage folder here in data types. And from now on, whenever I boot, the TIFF data type is not going to be enabled. This way you can have some of them disabled for some reason. This was really useful whenever we wanted whenever we wanted to save some of the memory of our system on machines that didn't have so much memories. Now on AmigaOS 4 we don't have that issue. And also it is useful whenever you want to test different data types, because especially for the images, there are a lot of different data types released by different developers. So you might want to test another data type from another developer and see how well it's working on your system. And sometimes it might be faster, or it might support more formats. This way you can move the current data types that you have on to the storage folder and save it for later. Let's say it is a backup folder. The same happens for every folder inside the storage. That's why we have the same folders between devs and storage. This is something that happens also in AmigaOS 3, and AmigaOS 4 continues that logic. In those drivers we have different let's say modules that extend the way that DOS communicates with ports on your hardware or other devices like CD-ROMs or whatever, and audio, of course. For me here we have also this ICD0 and IDF0 and the rest of these devices, which are the virtual devices that I can use on my system whenever I want to mount an ADF file or an ISO file or something. Then we have the key maps that the system uses and they are available, and those are the key maps that we can find also in preferences locale. That list here are the key maps that we have here. If you want to disable some of them, you can do it. But these are quite small files that most of the users do not disable at all. Monitors are the monitors that we have, and actually it refers to the graphics card that you have on your system. You might have more than one graphics card, because the Amiga One has multiple PCIe ports where you can connect different cards. We used to do that a long time ago when we wanted to support games that had a better support on Warp 3D. So we connected a Radeon 7000 graphics card, and then we could run games there. Now it doesn't. We don't need to do that, because with the Radeon HD and the Radeon RX drivers, we have support for the majority of the games out there that support Warp 3D and the Warp 3D Nova drivers. So we don't need to do it actually. Or you could also have different cards just to have multiple monitors on your desk. So you can open different applications to different options, to different monitors. That's possible to do that here. And actually what you do is putting in this folder in monitors all the different graphics cards configuration that you have for the monitors. For me, for example, here I have the Radeon and it is connected on my main monitor. So here you see this file, which has also some configuration, the tool types. I think we saw that when we saw the preferences about the monitors, where we set the different resolutions that are supported by my current monitor. So that's the monitors folder. Net interfaces are the network interfaces that you have on your system, and those are used to connect to the internet. This is the configuration, let's say the internet configuration that you have on your system. Thank you for the following. tears of me. Thank you very much. Livelo says, is possible to have two monitors with desktop stretched across with one graphics card? No, not yet. Unfortunately, that would be awesome. I don't know if there are if anyone is working on that, but that would be awesome. You can't do that with the drivers that we have right now. Also, that will be interesting if we, because most of the Radeon RX graphics cards and HD graphics cards have multiple connections for different monitors. They have HDMI, they have DVI, and etc. That would be awesome if a driver could do exactly that. Connect the different two different monitors on the same graphics card and have two an extended monitor. But right now this is not possible. The thing that you can do if you have a different graphics card on your system, you can have a different monitor connected with this graphics card and open another screen on that graphics card. For example, you could have on one monitor your let's say Directory Opus 5 Magellan screen, so you have the applications that you run through that, or a new screen that runs your browser, and on the your main screen, on another screen, you have the workbench. That is something that can be done. And in this folder, you have the printers that are the printer drivers that are mounted on your system on boot. The same thing happens on storage. Here we have so many others, but these are the ones that come pre-installed with the AmigaOS. And you can, if you want to enable some of them, you can drag and drop them inside devs, and after a reboot, they are always mounted. Or if you don't want to mount them on the boot, you can keep them on storage, but you can double click on that and they are mounted and can be used. Of course, in these folders, there are a lot of other hidden files that we can see here. And those are mostly devices that has to do with the different hardware that you have. For example, the audio system that you have, the AHI is also for the audio, disk image devices for disk drives and things like that, serial, etc. Hello, SLD Snake, welcome to the stream, welcome. Yeah, and that's mainly the devs and storage. There are crucial folders because you can have there mostly drivers for the devices that you have on your hardware. Hello, Ars Amiga, welcome to the stream, welcome. And those are, I say, I would like to repeat that the logic behind those two folders are exactly the same like on AmigaOS 3. So if you are experienced with how you can use them on AmigaOS 3, it's exactly the same thing on AmigaOS 4. Documentation folder, we discussed about that on another stream, is you have a lot of document files here that where you can find information. For example, in the C folder, you can find information about different commands that exist in the C folder. For example, how to use the CPU command and what you can do with that, or if you want to use, I don't know, the Avel, how you can do it. And there you can find a lot of information about almost everything. Let's see some of the hidden folders that come with AmigaOS 4. C folder, all the commands are there, classes, the different components of the AmigaOS are there. For example, the text fields or the window classes and things like that are in this folder. The different fonts that you are using are here in the fonts folder. There is also, we can talk later about the Kickstart L folder. It's also a folder that comes, if you are familiar with that from AmigaOS 3, it's exactly the same. You have here different handlers about file systems or about sound cards and things like that. They are crucial for the drivers to be used as well. Locale are the translations and they help other help files. We have here the catalogs where you can find all the translations for the different languages. I have a stream done for AmigaOS 3 where I talked about the locale and how you can use it and how you can create your own translations for different applications. The logic is exactly the same here for AmigaOS 4 and it is used exactly with the same way. The different time zones files where the time zones are configured. So whenever you go into the prefs and time zone select and you select there your time zone, here are the files that inform the system about the time zone of your country and whenever it changes for the HST, whenever the time changes and things like that. Aris Amiga says, can you import custom fonts on AmigaOS? Yeah, you can use TrueType fonts from other systems. You can copy them into the folder and then you can use the, what is it, here system, you can use the type manager and from that you can install that font into your system and you can use it. And also you can set, if it is possible, you can set the encoding that you want to use for that font. We have seen that on a previous stream when we saw about the system folder. I explained there the how this is used. Actually, I would like to say that all my streams, because the Twitch keeps only the last 15 days streams, all my older streams are on my YouTube channel, and you can find there all the previous streams that we did, which is actually right now we have done 21 streams, which is pretty awesome. So after that we have the S folder, of course, with the startup sequence scripts and some configuration files. We are all familiar with that, I guess. SObjs, we can see that as well a little bit later. T, which is a temporary folder, usually. This is a copy of my SObjs for testing. Cas and .cas, if you remember, we saw that on a previous stream, are the folders that I created for the thumbnails of the images to cast them there. I just created two. Let me delete one of them because we don't need it, or maybe later. So right now I would like to talk to you about these two folders. Of course, you see here some other folders like Enhancer, AmiSignix, Firmware, and this Qt folder. Those are going to be topics for different streams where I'm going to explain each and every one of them. Now, the SObjs is a folder where we have some libraries. If you are familiar with the Linux world, you might be understand exactly what these are. The .so files are also used on Linux, and they are mostly libraries that are used by different applications. The .so means shared objects, and those are libraries like the libraries that we are using on AmigaOS, but they have a different structure, of course. But the logic behind them is exactly the same. Instead of having too many files doing the same thing, you have libraries, and the applications open those libraries and use their API to do something. Since AmigaOS 4.1, I believe, a long time ago, these were introduced into the system. We have some kind of a usage of these .so files, the shared objects. Of course, they need to be recompiled for our system. So, for example, the libkernel here, it needs to be compiled from the open source community for the AmigaOS, and can be used by different applications. This work gave us the option, the possibility to port a lot of software from the open source community to AmigaOS, and especially applications like Blender or like FFPlay or MPlayer and things like that. And we have a lot of libraries already implemented, ported. And of course, we have a library SDL 1 and 2, which support a lot of games. And the games, after that, the games were possible also to be ported to AmigaOS. And that's one of the folders that you will not find in AmigaOS 3, and it's a different folder in AmigaOS. Actually, you won't find that folder at Morphos as well. It is not there. And the last folder that I would like to talk to you is Kickstart. As you know, the AmigaOS 4.1 runs on new hardware based on PowerPC, and the hardware is developed using latest technology on every component. For example, we are having PCI Express, we have fast DDR memories, the PowerPC, etc., and different graphics cards like Radeon Polaris, which is the RX, and the HD. SLD Snake says, I thought I saw some .so files under Amithlon, but no, I have checked those .o files, some kind of kernel drivers. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, they are possibly used only from the kernel of Amithlon while it boots, and then it is not used. Here they are used from the actual operating system and the applications that use them. And especially for porting games to AmigaOS, they played a crucial role, because the open source of games from the open source community require specific libraries to exist even for compiling them. So, as I was saying, the hardware that we are using to start booting to AmigaOS, it needs to understand the hardware. So the kernel uses those modules here, let's say. Let's call them modules. And each and every one of them describe a part of the hardware. For example, we have OHCI and UHCI, and we have EHCI at the top somewhere here, which all are different protocols about the USB usage of the hardware. So we have also some file systems, like here, fast file system, ng file system, and where is it? We have smart file system here, We have a module for the Xena CPU that comes on some Amiga ones. We have an intuition library, etc. Think about these modules like what would you find inside the Kickstart of the classic Amigas. Those are booted only when you do a hard boot on your system. So you boot from a shutdown machine to the AmigaOS, and it's the first thing that the kernel loads whenever you boot your system. Yeah, it's like the classic Kickstart ROM. Instead of course, having that on a ROM chip, you have that in software. And this is used, actually it was introduced as a logic from the early days of AmigaOS 4 versions, and gave that, based on that, it is possible for the AmigaOS to be ported to different hardware. Okay, so yeah, that's the main reason of these files. And also, inside this folder, there is a file named kick layout, which is, if we open that, you see it's just a text file. It has some information at the top, and below, in every line, there is a line that describes which modules to load. Based on this file, the loader starts and loads every one of these modules, and actually you can disable some of them based on your hardware. For example, here I have disabled, I don't know if it is visible on your screen, I have here disabled some of the modules because actually on my system I don't have this hardware. These are for serial LATA PCI cards, or as well as I disabled these graphics card chips because I don't need them, so I can disable it and speed up a little bit the loading of my system. Or if something is not working well, for example, in the old Micro Amiga one, I know that you have to disable the EHCI USB module because it is there is a problem with the hardware. There are bugs with the hardware and it is not working well. SLD Snake says, does that X5000 has an SD port for some kind of Kickstart SD card, or am I mistaken? The X5000, the A1222 and the X1000, they have a flash memory where the first code is the U-boot is installed. For the X1000 it is called a CFE boot. This is necessary for the system to start and start loading from this folder the modules. To start the loader is this file here that you can see, the loader, and that loads the kernel and then loads all these modules. So yeah, there is an SD memory or CF on X1000, a CF memory that is needed just to kickstart the hardware to load the first files from your system. After that, after the kernel loads, then the operating system starts loading. So here we can change what exactly we want to load, and also you can create different configuration names, as you can see, configurations. As you can see here, I have only one. If you see here, we have a configuration name, label, this one, and then executes the load, the loader and starts loading all these files. If I would like to have a different one, for example, for debugging, I could create a copy of that. For example, let's say from here, copy and paste it here. I could do that and change some of the change first of all the label, final edition 2, for example, and change the modules that I would like to load at the boot. If I do that, then whenever I boot my machine, there is a page, there is a screen where you see different configurations on your hardware, and there you will see the new one configuration that I created, and you can select that while you boot your system. If you want to boot on this configuration or not, you might want to have a different one for where you have disabled all the let's say USBs, for example. I usually use that to have different kernels loaded, because we have for debugging we have the kernel debug and the kernel which is the kernel debug is a kernel that spits out a lot of information at the serial port. Every installation has those two versions of kernel installed inside this Kickstart folder. But only the basic kernel is enabled. So yeah, this folder is also extremely necessary, and if for some reason your system stops loading, this is one of the folders that you have to visit and see if everything is there as it should be, and if it works well. Especially the kick layout in cases this was broken for some reason. Although I never had something like that as an experience, I never experienced the kick layout to be broken on my system. And this was also something that is updated whenever a new update is released by the Hyperion for the AmigaOS 4. The package that was released at the start of this year, it had changes for the Kickstart, and there was some changes that you needed to do in the kick layout file. So to add some information about, depending on your system, about the modules that were loaded at boot. And that's why there was a step that asked the users to open the editor and add some line inside this file. Actually, for the most of the modules, the order of the files, it's not something that you should care of, except the first ones for the kernel here and the loader. You should have as first in the in the row the loader, of course, and yeah, most of the others, there's no problem to put it wherever you want. We keep mostly an order based on the first letter, so that if we need to find something, you can find it faster, sorted by the name of the module. And that's for the Kickstart. And these two folders, the SObjs and Kickstart, is the basic differences from the AmigaOS 3. I don't see any other folder different from what we have on AmigaOS 3. What I would like to show you also is a few more things that has to do on accessing different computers and mount hard disks from computers that you have on your system, on your network at home. SLD Snake says more or less like the old Kickstart, exec lib first, the next ones doesn't need to be arranged. Yeah, exactly. It's exactly the same, the same logic. Let's say that you have different folders, different computers on your network, especially if you have a NAS computer, a network system, where you have all your music files or videos or I don't know, photographs and everything like that, and you would like to connect to them. There are different ways to do it. You can connect with an application using FTP, for example, but with the AmigaOS, it is possible to mount as a hard disk almost everything, and you can mount as well network folders that are available on different computers. You can do that also on other systems, on other operating systems. So let's see how you can do that here on AmigaOS. One of the things that you can do, especially for Windows shared folders, is to use the Samba. And for AmigaOS 4, there is SMBFS. This is something that exists for AmigaOS 3 as well, and you can, whatever we see here, you can apply that to AmigaOS 3 as well. And let me show you how you can do it. I have here, first of all, let me find the archive. SMBFS is something that you can download from Aminet or the GitHub page of the developer. Okay, here is it. The latest version is 2.1. Let me extract it in RAM. SMBFS, here it is. So it is a command, a simple command, which you have to copy into your path. You can copy it on C folder. That's where I have it, if I'm not wrong. Dir SMB. Here it is. Let's see the version. From 2018. So you can download that and copy that file into your C folder, and you can use it wherever you want. It is a command that you can use it from a shell, or if you have a specific mount that you would like to do every time, you can do what I did here. I created a script. Some of them are commented out, and just to show you how you can do it, I created a script which runs the SMBFS, connects on my workgroup here on my network, and mounts, creates a mounted volume named working to service is the system that has that shared folder. Livelo says Samba was the first thing I tried setting up with AmigaOS 4.1, but it didn't work. I gave up, but would like to have it. It is a little bit problematic, because Samba is something that was developed by the open source community to give the users the option to mount shared folders from Microsoft computers. Back then, to do it, they used reverse engineering and That is, if you don't have the source code of how Microsoft did it, or some guidelines on how to do it yourself, and you use reverse engineering, of course it might have issues. There are two versions, Samba 1 and Samba 2. The Samba 1 supports, I think, up to the Windows XP. Samba 2 is more is better and supports Windows 10 and above. But I think that you can use Samba 1 versions to mount Windows 10 shares if you change some information on your Windows machine. To be honest, I don't use it a lot. I have different ways to connect with those machines, and I will show you later. But and also the for the AmigaOS, we have only the Samba 1 version. We don't have a version that supports Samba 2 protocol. So our solutions there and our possibilities are limited. With Samba, you could also connect to shared printers, for example. Now, for AmigaOS, there are two different Samba packages. The one is the SMBFS, like I show here, which is only to mount a network folder that is shared on Windows machines. And there is also the a bigger package that installs Samba on your system, and you can share your folders with the Samba protocol to other machines as well, which is much more complicated to set up. Libero says, I use it on my Linux computer, don't have Windows, did not have issues with it there. Yeah, because it is it supports more, it supports both protocols. I think for the Windows 10, they dropped the support of the first version of the their Exchange connection. I use it here, and the demonstration that I'm going to do is with my NAS, which is based on Linux, and it also has Samba, a way to share folders with that Samba protocol. SLT Nexus SMB became very tricky. Those security holes from the last years killed the first version. Yes, exactly. Exactly. Hello, Doda 1200. Hello, welcome to the stream. At first, there are a much newer than on Aminet, and second, it has a bit tricky command line format. Dota, you mean about the SMBFS? Because the latest version that I found on developers GitHub is 2.1. If there is a newer version and you have a link, please post it on the chat, because I'm pretty interested, because I have some issues with this version, and if there is a newer version, that will be awesome. So this SMB, this shared folder doesn't have any passwords or doesn't require a specific user to connect to that, so I don't have that configured here. But if you have a folder that requires a password, a specific password, you can use these two different arguments, one for the user to set which user will connect, and the password of this user, and connect with that. So right now, if I run it on terminal, I can connect with this folder. But instead of whenever I want to mount those folders, instead of going and writing down the same command all the time, I created this script. And when you have a script, you can go to the information of the icon, set it as a script here, and also as a default tool, set the icon X. If you do that, that is something that you can do with whatever script you want on the AmigaOS. If you do that, you can double click on the icon, and this executes the script in this file. As you can see here, I have some issues with this version of my system. It throws me a grim reaper, which means that there's something wrong with the software, but fortunately I can ignore it and let it continue, I guess. And here I have the a new hard disk on my desktop. That's the mounted hard disk of the mounted folder from the system that I have that shared folder from my NAS, for example, right now. So right now I can use it like any hard disk on my system, so I can open it and show all the files. It takes some time because it connects to the other on my network machine, and also there are a lot of files here. Let me see them, show them all, and you can go here and open some stuff. For example, let me open let me find something like this. Let me open that. Okay, something better like that. So you can open images, you can open whatever you want, like it was on your actual machine. The difference is that you grab it from another machine on your network. Livelo says, so it is working, I will have to try some again. Yeah, it is working. I'm not sure if it is only on my machine that it crashes on the start, but it is working pretty good. And you can start images, music, MP3 files, for example. You can drag and drop them into the Amiga amp and listen to the music just fine. And videos as well. Unfortunately, from my experience, it is not that fast as a solution, but you can try it. I remember that back in 2005, this was the only option I could share files from other machines, and I could even play videos from that small resolution, not 1080p resolution. Actually, I don't remember if back in 2005 if we had videos on 1080p. We didn't have it. But yeah, it is a good solution to use it on your system. Dota 1200 says, you are right, the version from GitHub is the right one, but you said we can download SMVFS from Aminet. Yes, I did exactly that in the past, but the version from Aminet is old, almost unusable. Let me have a look, because SMBFS. Yeah, it is 1.74. You are right. You are right, Dota. This is quite old. This is quite old version, and I think I found mine on OS4 depot. SMBFS. Yeah, here on OS4 depot there is version 2.1. I don't see. Yep, here it is. And if you read the README file, I think here, yes, it is the GitHub page of the developer. Olaf Barthel is the developer. Olaf is one of the developers for AmigaOS as well, AmigaOS 3, and he also develops AmigaOS 4 parts. He also is the developer from Roadshow. He is the maintainer of Fastfile system right now. He is doing so many things, so I guess we can trust any software that he develops. So if you click here on GitHub and you go to that page, of course it is, doesn't look well on Amiga on iBrowse, but it is quite fast. GitHub loads extremely fast in iBrowse, and there is releases, and here you can find the Amiga SMBFS 2.1 as well, and here is also the 68K version, which you can use on AmigaOS 3. So whatever you do here, whatever you see here on this stream, it is also doable on AmigaOS 3, this part. Little Lord says, I tried the version from OS for the bot, if I recall correctly. Yes, 2.1. Yes, Dota, you are right. It's better to use the one from the GitHub and not from the Aminet. Hello, Imek. Hello, welcome to the stream. You use SMB mounter available on OS for the bot. It stores your SMB configs and you can select which one to connect and mount. That's awesome. Yeah, that was something that I would like to mention as well. There are a lot of, you mean this SMB mounter. There is also this Savvy PPC. There are a lot of other GUI programs that actually use that SMBFS program and helps a lot to make that process more simple for you. To be honest, in my opinion, of course, for me it is much simpler if I have something like that, because you can double click and start all the, and mount all the shared folders that you want. But yeah, if it is more convenient for someone to use a GUI, this is possible. And maybe you can find other solutions, because here there is already, I see, four of them, four different applications that are GUIs for SMBFS. Feel free to try something of that, and based on what you do, it might be better for you. Livelo says, I followed Amiga Samba Idiot's guide. Wow, that goes so far back on WordPress. Yeah, still not sure. This was created by Mikey C, if I'm not wrong, right? Still not sure if it was for me or the instructions were outdated. Possibly they were outdated. I remember that guide back in 2005, 2006. And yeah, actually you don't need, if you just want to mount a shared folder from another system, you don't need to follow that those steps, because with SMBFS it's just a line of code code to run on your terminal, just a command away, and you can mount the folder that you want. If you want to share your Amiga folders based on the Samba network, Samba protocol, then you can use that guide. But I doubt that anyone would like to do that. It would be better to start an FTP server on your system. Let me see right here, FTP. We talked about that on my last stream, if I'm not wrong. There is a FTP server which you can use. There is Zeta FTP server, which is based on the features, is the best one out there. And I think there is also FTPD, which is FTP daemon, which you can use as well, but it is a little bit more tricky to use. To set up, because it needs some more steps to do it. But I would prefer to use something like an FTP. It's much easier to set up than Samba. Samba is not SMFS. SMFS. If you want just mount remote disk, SMFS is enough. SMBFS, yeah. SMBFS is the is enough. Yeah, actually what I did is this, I installed SMBFS on my C folder and I executed that. And if you want, and what you can do right now to dismount that folder, we have a working here and we want to remove it. Either you can reboot, but there is also a better way. If you do status on your terminal, you will see here that there is a process that uses the SMBFS for this shared folder. So what you need to do here is, let me remember, to kill that process, and you do that by, of course there is no command kill. Let me check the documentation. Let me find it. Status. Yes. Ah, yeah, break. So you write break and the number of the process here. And that, then this process is terminated. So the specific mount is removed. Yeah. That's why I always have the documentation close to what I need to do. It's always useful. Little says, I was looking to share both ways, Amiga NAS, for easier backup purposes, but FTP is working for me as well. Yes, yeah, it is a good solution, and you can trust it better than, at least on my experience, better than SMB, than Samba. Dota says, understand Samba is not super easy task. That's right. Yeah. Look, if you do it and it works, then it will always work just fine, unless you change something on your machine that has to do with these shared folders. Otherwise, it will work just fine, and you can always use it. Another way to do it, and this is a way to do it on AmigaOS 4 only. Let me show you that. If you go to the L, there is this SSH2 handler. This handler here introduced to AmigaOS 4.1 final edition on the second update that happened back in January, if I'm not wrong. That was the first time that this was released. If you have your installation there and you check in the L, you will find that file there. What you can do with that, here you can use it to connect with another computer using SSH, which is also more secure. Okay, and this is a standard process that most of the Linux servers are using. For example, right now I can mount my web server that I have somewhere in Germany or Finland, if I'm not wrong, somewhere in Europe. I can mount its hard disk and do changes there from my Amiga, upload stuff and things like that. But I want to use it for something more simple and mount my folders on my NAS. So what you can do to do that, let me show you. I have created here in my storage, in DOS drivers, I created a device, a script that uses that handler, and mounts the folders, the specific disk that I want to mount. So let me show you. I gave it the name Thecus because that's the name of my NAS that I'm using. If I open the information here, you will see that I'm doing a mount, activate is equals to one. And let me open that because it's just a description file, a text file. It uses like a handler, the SSH2 handler. It gives it some stack size, priority, and whatever it needs. And you have here a startup command that uses with that handler. I give it the address and the IP. The argument host address, it's the IP. For port, the port of the SSH server that runs on that machine, and the user that I'm going to use. And actually, if you go here to the documentation and try to find the file SSH2 in this folder only, if you find it in other handlers, so if you go handlers here, there is SSH2 handler, and you can see here in the README all the information about what you need to give it. From the here in this folder that you create, it has all the things that you see here on my own script, and you can give it the password if you want. Anything. I prefer not to give the password because you never know where this file might end, so I don't save passwords in text files, right? But it's pretty easy to do it, and by double clicking on that, it will ask for my password. So if I give it my password, right now it mounted the hard disk of my system, the NAS. You see that it's much faster than the Samba. And you can use it like you do with any hard disk on your system. Backup disk. Let me see something here. Clean up. Different files. Let me see if I have something to show you. And it plays the video just fine from the network, which is pretty interesting. This is a presentation that I did a lot of years ago. Anyway, I forgot that I have that. Or open with a double click an image on your system, or a text file if you want to do it, or an MP3, whatever you have on your system. And this comes with your AmigaOS 4. With that, you can have access to whatever server you have SSH installed there. So if you have a server that you can access with SSH term, if you remember, we saw that that application on my last stream. Which is a terminal, CD here. That's exactly the same hard disk that I have here. Exactly the same things. You can see there, the same files. Little SSH is even better. Thanks for that's for me. It's much better solution. Of course, it is not for Windows machines. I don't know. Actually, I never installed SSH server on a Windows machine, so it is tricky to make it work. I believe that it is possible. I haven't done that. I believe that it is tricky to do it on a Windows machine, but I am sure that there is going to be a way to do it. It is a good way if you have a NAS on your system to use it to mount your hard disks and gain access there and copy files or delete files or whatever you want. Especially based also on your permissions that the user that you are using here with this handler, the permissions that if he has permission to write, he's going to be able to write there. So let me close that. And as I said, you can even mount your server from so many miles away, and you can mount it as a hard disk on your system for backup, for example, if you have a storage somewhere. And to remove that mounted disk, you can do dismount. This is a command in C as well here, and it requests for the device, and the device is the one that you find up here on the name. So if I say Thecus, but before I do that, let me show you one more thing that you can have access to that through any file manager, right? You can have access from the old good Director Opus 4 like any hard disk on your system, and that's also pretty neat. So dismount Thecus, that's the name of my device, enter, and it is removed simply like that. And I find it quite useful, right? Yeah, especially if you have on your system a NAS server where you have everything there. It is pretty good to use a solution like that to access your music, for example. Although that I'm going to change that way to do it with the next version of Media Vault. And what I'm creating there with the support for DLNA servers, where you are going to have a very nice way to access your music and videos on other DLNA servers. So, but this is coming. This is a work. I'm working on that. It's a work in progress. So, this is coming. For example, let me give you a sneak peek on that, and I hope it won't crash. If you go here, there is a new selection which says media servers. It might change on the end on the new version when it is going to be released. And here it brings a list of all the servers that I have on my network. This might be a Plex, this might be Twonky, I have here Jellyfin. The first one is my router, for example, that has the ability to connect a hard disk on a USB, connect your USB there, and then the content that you have on your USB, videos, music, photographs, are able to be shared with any device that supports DLNA connection there. And that is going to be available here on Media Vault. So the idea here is to double click on the server that you want, and then find the video that you want to play. It has some folders here. You can select the music, videos, whatever you want, and go deeper and deeper, and find the music or the videos that you want to play and play them to the player that you will, your beloved player, for example, the emotion or anything else. But it's coming. It's going well. Levelosess, exactly. This is good to set up before the DLNA is supported. I'm super glad that you can use directory opus as a file manager. Didn't really expect that. Yeah, since the any network folder is mounted as a folder on your workbench, it can be used by any application, any file manager. And that's what we are going to do right now, because there is a third way to share files, folders from other machines using the FTP. And there is also an old package. You can find it for AmigaOS 3. It was released a long time ago, but there is also a version for AmigaOS 4, and this is the FTP mount. Let me find it here. Here it is, 1.5. I think I have that installed. I have that downloaded, but not installed, and I would like to install it with you. What you can do with FTP mount is actually mount a hard disk, create a hard disk on your system, mounted by a remote FTP folder, account. Whatever, server. And let's see how we can do it. To be honest, I haven't done that before. I haven't used it. I have a lot of years to use it. And I would like to do it with you, because this stream is also doing stuff together. And if there are problems, see how we can solve them. So this version is from 2006, a lot of years ago. Should we trust the installer? I'm not sure. As you know from my previous streams, I would like first to understand what an installer does, especially if it is quite old and you don't know. Since then, since 2006, the AmigaOS 4 changed a lot. So I would like to be a little bit more careful on what I'm installing, especially because my system is a beta testing system. Okay, so I would like to know exactly what is in here. So I see here an FTP mount handler, two of them, which I guess they are installed in the L folder of AmigaOS, so I guess it is installed here. Let me put them there. Okay. And what else we have? We have quick remove, quick install, some scripts, I guess. Let me check. Yeah. These are AmigaDOS scripts. You see echo, cd, assign. There are commands that you can do on your terminal. Okay, we have that FTP. I guess that this, yes, this is the mount. It's exactly the same like what I have for the SSH handler. So I guess the FTP mount is something that uses those handlers to mount something somewhere. Okay, so let me check if I open that on a text editor. You see, it's exactly what I have on the SSH. So if I go to storage, those drivers, if I open the FECOS that I used for the SSH, you see all the similarities are exactly the same. Great. Okay, so I guess that I can use this in my storage. FTP mount readme, hosts, Aminet. Okay, these are just folders. Let me open the mount. Usage. If you haven't chosen to install FTP mount permanently, you will have to start quick install first. After usage, you can then use quick remove. Those two scripts. So they copy and remove files, I guess. The default operation of FTP mount is to take references to directories in the root of FTP as FTP site addresses. Addresses can be dotted names or dotted numbers. If the address contains a NAT, the string to the right of the AT will be taken as the address, while that to the left is assumed to be a username. Okay. If no AT is present, an anonymous login is attempted with user FTP and FTP and password of user host. Okay. Let's see how we can do it. Okay, what I'm going to do is copy that to my DOS drivers inside storage, because if you don't put it inside storage and you go and put them inside dev's DOS drivers, then these will be mounted on every boot of your machine. So if you want to do that, if you want to have a shared folder mounted whenever you start your machine, you can move that description file to your devs, and this is going to happen. If you do that, you better have the password inside the configuration file here, so that it will not wait for you to type the password. But I prefer to start that job to do it whenever I want to mount those files, those folders, sorry. So I have the handlers copied, I have the FTP here. Okay. It's been established, the requester will be on the screen indicating that the connection is being established and containing a cancel button to abort the connection. Once the connection is established, the FTP site will be accessible as normal. Okay, there are tool types. Oh, great. There are some tool types that you can use. Note that setting tool types is best done on the original drawer icons in FTP mount dir. Hosts. Okay, so it needs also an assign. Let me see this one. Oh yes. As you can see, it refers to FTP mount dir colon hosts. Cancel. So that folder here is used possible to whenever you want to mount something, an FTP account. So we have to use okay, let me see where we can put that host. I will put it inside my home. I will create a folder named FTP mount. And in there, I will put the guide, the readme, the host. Okay, let's put those things as well. And let's copy those two in case we need them. Cancel. Come on. In case we need them later. And then what I'm going to do is open a terminal and do an assign FTP mount dir to not utils but to this folder. Okay. If I check the assigns, I logically we'll have here an FTP mount dir that points to that folder. Okay, so if I come again here and set as a tool type the user, FTP user, I have the host equals to 192. This is the NAS server that I'm using. I have there a user. I have there an FTP folder. Let me use the user equals FTP. I will not put the password yet to see if it will ask me about that. Root specifies an alternate. Okay. Directory to use as a root of the site. Okay, let's mount it by double clicking on that. Doesn't do anything. Not really. Okay, let me try again. Let me see if I have it mounted. No. Devices here. Assign. I don't have that. No, I have an FTP. It was there before? No. Okay. If I dismount it, FTP. Okay. I guess it is removed now. Yes, it is not there. So we can try it again. I will change the monitor to write the password. Sorry about that, guys. Give me a sec. In case this is the problem. Okay, let's try that again. But this time I will try to do it from this folder. So see, from the terminal, to see if we get any errors. No, nothing. If we do FTP, nothing, unknown command. Okay. Did anyone try it before? Okay, let's see what that does. It makes the assign. Great. Okay, we have the host, local host. Ah, is there a possibility that it needs a folder with the IP, the host name here? Let me try that again. I don't see anything. Okay. Assign the FTP mount dir. Adding directory of the global path. Utils full name, FTP mount. Okay. Okay, let's do that. Quick install. Assign FTP mount dir to the current directory, done. Adding FTP mount directory to the global path, done. Now you are able to mount and activate the FTP device. Do you want to mount and activate it now? Yes. Mounting and activating the FTP device, mount, object not found. Because it is not here. Let me copy that here. Dismount the FTP manually and try again the quick install. Okay, activate it, yes. Installation complete. It's not a directory, mounting and activating. Okay. I think you use different IP address for the drawer you created than it is in the tool type. Oh, you think so? Let me see the assigns. Okay. Let me dismount the FTP. Let me check that. Oh yeah, you're right. Give me a sec, guys, to change that. Okay. You were right, Livelord. Thank you for paying attention. Okay. Yeah, the IP that I had in the tool types here, it was wrong. It was a different one. So let me do again with the install. Do you want to mount the active? Okay. It's not a directory. Dear directory not found. Mounting and activating the FTP device. So it tries to mount the FTP device and then tries to delete FTP. Yeah, known command. Is there something that I'm missing here? Host, we have that. FTP mount. Okay, we have everything. Yes. Okay. Dismount FTP. And let me see, mount this one. Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't seem to work, or it needs some extra control of FTP mount. Unreliable nature of the net, connections to FTP sites go up and down, go really slowly. Okay. If I do, let me check the quick remove. This one. This script here goes to that path. Okay, let me try killing everything, because we run it so many times. So I guess here, if I do assign, there is FTP here. Okay. If I do a quick install, it's already mounted, so it can't mount it. Okay. Let me do one last test. You mean, Livelord says, is it case sensitive for your drawer is all lowercase? You mean here, this one, or the FTP mount? Because it doesn't make any change, because the assign that it does points to the specific folder. It doesn't have any problem. And the file system of AmigaOS is not case sensitive at all. In the doc, it was referring to the FTP mount dir while you have FTP mount drawer. Yes, that's the name of the assign that is created. If I go again here, it says FTP mount dir host, and that's the name of the assign. it doesn't have to be the same the name of the folder to be the same with the assign, because you can make this assignment anywhere you want. This mount FTP sign, we don't have that. Okay, quick install again one more time. Dear director not found, let me see that. Okay, FTP help. You see here it sets some environment variables. Okay, do you want to mount dir activated? So it does FTP mount dir. We have that assignment here. Assign. Let me see that. FTP mount dir is in the specific folder that I added that. That's right. And tries to mount, as I did manually earlier, it tries to mount this one. And then tries to, yeah, that's where it fails. It tries to dir the FTP device. Possible it doesn't work after it is quite old, or I'm doing something completely wrong. Okay, if the connection is a private non-anonymous FTP session, a requester asking for a password will be opened. Okay, let's try something else. Let's go here, FTP mount. Let's remove that. But before, let me, okay. Awesome, close. Let me remove this one that I have for my local NAS and copy that again here and try to connect to Aminet, to mount the Aminet, which doesn't need any username and password, right? So if we go to aminet.net, if I'm not wrong, it is ftp.aminet. Let me see. If we add here a host, retrace usage, two type options, host. Used as the address of the site to connect to instead of the name of the directory. Okay. This is useful for making abbreviated aliases for sites. The host name can contain comma to start the port number, example. Okay. Okay, so if I do host equals to ftp.aminet.net, ftp.aminet.net, save. Let's try that. Yes. Let me dismount it first and try that again. Okay, this mount FTP and try that again. Yes. Yeah, it doesn't work, unfortunately. I will dig a little bit more on that the weekend, and possibly on the next stream I'm going to have the solution or not. It's main.aminet.net. Let's try that as well before we give up. So if I do main.aminet.net, right? Main.aminet.net. Okay. Save. Quick install. The worst thing here is that it doesn't return any information why it failed. Directory not found. Okay. And it fails quite fast, which seems like it doesn't even try to connect. Okay. Anyway, I will find a way to make it work, if it works at all. It just needs some more time to dig it a little bit deeper. But yeah, if the FTP mount works, it is a way to mount any FTP account, any FTP server on your desktop. For anonymous access to Aminet FTP, use ftp.v.de, for example. If I'm sure it's working. Okay. Do we have here any assigning? No. Let's try that again as well. ftp.fau.de. Quick install. No, it doesn't work. I don't believe it tries to connect at all. I don't believe it does it. Let me try something else as a last try, and then I'm going to give up for now. Yeah, I don't think it's on the address. It doesn't seem to try to mount it at all. Let me do anonymous at main.aminet.net. And if I fail to make it work, I'm probably going to contact the developer of FTP mount and see if he can help in any way. Okay, quick install. Okay, yes. No. Unfortunately, but it will be a good thing to have it running, because it is also good to have a way to connect with an FTP account, any FTP account. It might be something that you want to set up really fast, and FTP is a fast protocol to connect and exchange files. So yeah, I will work on that to make it work if possible. And I can show you next Friday on my stream. Let's start some music here. So Yeah, there are a lot of ways to make to get files from another machine or connect to anywhere with the AmigaOS 4. My preferred way, as I told you earlier, is the one with the SSH handler. It's much more simple, and actually it is something that is still maintained by the AmigaOS developers, and yeah, I trust it a lot more connected with SSH than anything else, to be honest. And yeah, but please tell me, what else would you like to see based on how to connect and get what else would you recommend to use on AmigaOS to do something like that? Also, as I said, there are FTP servers that you can run on your Amiga so that you can get files from anywhere, from any other machine. And yeah, that's what I would like to share with you today. I will make the FTP mount work. I'm sorry about that. And I'm just a little bit confused why this doesn't work, but I remember that it was a good solution also with the AmigaOS 3. So FTP mount is a very nice utility for AmigaOS 3. The SMBFS is a very nice solution for AmigaOS 3 as well. But for AmigaOS 4, you can have the SSH handler as well. So thank you everyone for being here. I would like to thank you all for joining me on this stream, and for joining me on every stream that I'm doing every Friday. Livelos says, I use PFTP for FTP, it never failed. PFTP is a client to connect to an FTP server, right, Livelor? I think so. It's this one. PFTP. This one, you mean, right? Yeah, that's a client to connect to any FTP. We have that. We have AMI FTP as well, which is a port from the AMI FTP from AmigaOS 3, and we also have the RNO Expert, which is very nice client, which also support SFTP, which is for secure connection to FTP server. Very good. And this, I believe, is with SFTP you can connect through SSH with the FTP protocol on your server, which is also quite secure, and you can connect anywhere and download files. But I wanted to show you some solutions that have us in the where you mount the folders on your desktop to exchange files, which is very nice to have. I would like to thank you all for being here. I would like also to thank my supporters. As you know, I have a support page at ko-fi/Volquero, where you can support me for all the software that I'm creating, and I keep them open source if possible, for everyone to have access to the code, and also for the streams that I'm creating. And also I would like to mention here that 50% of my monthly donations are donated to other projects. Every last day of each month I donate 50% of the donations to specific projects that have to do with the Amiga and with the AmigaOS, and so to support other developers out there. I would like to thank my Amiga Pulse supporters, which is Daniel Trixie Genlica, Livelord, and Roman Kagi, and all my supporters that donated to my page. And you can connect with me at Twitter, which is gsokianos, my account. And also you can learn information of on what I'm doing, what I develop, and any updates from me at my Ko-fi page, because I post their blog posts maybe twice per week, and I keep you informed on everything I'm doing. I'd like to thank you again for being here, guys. Thank you very much for joining me and keep some company to me on these streams. Let's see if we can raid someone who is streaming right now. Let me have a look. How about raiding Hits? He's always streaming something retro. He's playing on Spectrum, I guess. Maybe using the AND service. So let's say hello to Hits. Let me see. Okay. So thank you very much, everyone, for being here. Have a great evening, and I will see you next week, next Friday, on the next stream. And yeah, take care. Have a great weekend, and see you soon. Bye bye, everyone.